A lot of my writing is inspired by real situations, because I think truth is stranger than fiction, and I like the things that I learn about real stories that you wouldn't dare to invent, and I like that. So I do a fair amount of research for these things. It was not only Dana Zátopková that I talked to for this book. I talked to a runner, a guy by the name of Hruška, who used to run with Zátopek. There weren't as many people alive anymore from those days. I've read a bunch of books. I've read all his biographies and stuff. And all that stuff somehow, you know, percolates and comes in handy. I was mostly interested in this one incident, which is this private strike and Helsinki. And there were several books written about Zátopek, one of them quite good in the 50s, biographies, but there was no mention. They were all published under the communist regime still, under censorship. So there was no mention of this one incident. So I was really interested in the particulars of how it happened. And she told me a lot of really interesting things that I would have never imagined or invented. It was an interesting time. It was under Stalin.
Zátopkův příběh je přínosný pro současnost asi furt stejně jako vždycky, že člověk se prostě musí vlastně postavit. On mohl skončit jako 90% jeho spoluobčanů jakoby ve fabrice, u Bati nebo v Gotwaldově, že a prostě běhat jenom rekreačně a tak, ale a on chtěl z té fabriky ven, to je to očividný na tým jeho příběhu, nechtěl prostě celý život dělat ve fabrice. A když už se tam prokopal ven, tak vlastně si ještě furt přikládal, ještě furt nestačilo mu být nejlepší v republice, ale chtěl být nejlepší na světě, že jo, a nebál se toho, takže jako to je o ty obrovský vůli, o tom prostě se zatnout a jet jak mašina, dokud prostě jakoby to není hotový, dokud nemá tu medaili. Což já, když jsem na tom pracoval, na tom komiksu, tak to bylo dost podobné, protože to je jako roční práce a vždycky jsem si říkal to jeho heslo, když nemůžeš, tak přidej, tak protože prostě když je člověk v polovině komiksu, třeba na těch 100 stranách, tak si říká, že už má dost, ale prostě je to takový maraton, že jo. Tak on, který jakoby maraton vyhrál v Helsinkách, tak tomu já jsem se vlastně tím příběhem blížil a jsem říkal, tohle musím doběhnout, no. Takže on je velice inspirativní, myslím si, nejen pro sportovce.
My name's David Hine, and I've been lucky enough to be involved as editor on a new graphic novel from Self-Made Hero. It's an adaptation of The Ragged Trousered Philanthropists by Robert Tressel, and I'm here with the artist and the writer, Sophie and Scarlett Rickard.
We are sisters, so right from the very beginning we've been playing together, if you like. Right from when we were little, I would be telling Scarlett what to draw. Our first collaboration was an original fiction called Man's Best Friend, which is about a man who doesn't like his dog. Our next thing to come out is this, The Ragged Trousered Philanthropists, and it's a book that we felt was perfect for adaptation because people love it, but it's quite hard to read. So we've made a very accessible, fun adaptation of what can be quite a difficult book.
When I was first approached about this book by Emma Haley at Self-Made Hero, I remember she had no idea that I even knew the book existed. But in fact, my grandfather was a painter and decorator from the 1920s through to the late 1950s. He pretty much lived the life that is described in this book. And in his house, he had two books. He had the Bible and he had the Ragged Trousered Philanthropists. And that book made him into a communist. This is the book that changed his life. Would you like to tell us a little bit about how you work with Sophie? What happens when you actually get that script?
Sophie reduced the original down from 255,000 words to about 30,000. I started making a very, very basic storyboard, very scribbly. And then I drew the whole thing on the iPad. I did it entirely digitally and was averaging about a page a day. And then at the end of every day, I'd send the page to Sophie and then we'd have a good laugh about it or talk about what we had to change or whatever.
At the end of each chapter, we would bundle it up and send it to Dave. In the first few chapters, we'd get quite a lot of notes. You taught us so much craft. And then I'd like to say that by the later chapters, your notes got fewer and fewer because we learnt something. Do you agree?
I do completely agree that my job became very easy as the book progressed. I was getting to the point where I was thinking, what comments can I make this time? I hate hearing it when people say, it's been such an honour. But I did actually feel that with this book, it was so important to myself and to my entire family, really, that to be involved with the book it's really been important to me.
The difficulty in being a late bloomer has to do with your identity as a friend, a husband, a wife, a colleague, etc. is really settled. And it's suddenly changing, and that produces a lot of choices and challenges. Who am I, really? For some, it's like starting life all over again, becoming a teenager again, etc. You throw all the fixed expectation up in the air, and maybe you catch some of them, and maybe you start a completely new life, a new way of living. Coming out, for my part, was in every way a liberation. One of my old friends said, when I realized I was gay, and this is a sin being a Muslim, I decided I could just as well start drinking. Hi, I'm Anne. I'm the author of When I Came Out. It's a graphic novel about the rabbit Louise, and she's a late bloomer. It's autofictional, and it's also a lot of other things. I hope you'll enjoy it. Thank you.